If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this episode of Mind Pump, me and the boys have some nice casual and fun conversation the entire time.
That's what you called it.
We talk about our LA day trip. We actually flew in at like 9 a.m.
Note to self, don't do that again.
At 9 p.m. Adam was irritable. Yeah. Then we talk about trends. Not quite sure what trends we talked about. We had to go pee before recording this intro. We talk about Adam's top five business people that he would pick if he could work with them.
Some interesting answers on there.
I guess I pissed off a lot of people when I did that.
Yeah, they didn't like that.
We talk about gimmicky diets and one that I invented that I think would be a $1 billion idea.
Unfortunately, it's super brilliant, and I hate to give you credit for that.
Yeah, but I won't do it because
we have integrity.
Too much integrity, unlike Dr. Integrity. Then we talk about the history of muscle-building supplements. This whole episode, great conversation. We had a lot of fun recording it. You're going to love it.
Yeah. You forgot, too, that we mentioned Organifi in this episode.
Oh, we did, didn't we? Yeah. We mentioned Organifi in this episode.
We mentioned our sponsor, and you don't even mention them.
Son of a bitch. You can get a discount on Organifi supplements if you go to OrganifiShop.com, enter the code MINDPUMP.
I was getting sick at the beginning of the week, got better, and then we did this thing yesterday, and now I feel bad again.
Of course.
You got worked on hard. You got drilled in your jaw.
Oh, my jaw.
Oh, yeah.
My jaw hurts.
It literally
really
hurts,
dude. Drilled.
What a great trip.
That guy was having his way.
What a great trip we had.
Yeah.
It was productive. I like those trips.
I do too, but boy, was I exhausted.
You know
you
what?
Exhausted?
I get to a point.
I lost my voice a little bit.
So I get to a point where I get tired, and then when I push past tired, now I can't sleep. Yeah. That's what happened to me last night.
Oh, no. I was laying in bed. You know what? It's so funny. So I'm laying in bed. And, you know, Katrina has a lot to do with organizing all this stuff as far as our schedules and things like that. So she always likes to hear how it went, you know, like how'd it go. And, you know, she works real hard to make a lot of these connections, relationships, and the timing and all that work out. And
your answers were real short.
Yeah. So it's
fun. Me too.
We roll in at 11:30 at night, right? And, you know, I climb
and we left early that morning.
Yeah.
We're nonstop to the point where we did not eat.
It felt like 2 days.
Yeah.
Like you said.
We didn't eat. Remember? Yeah. We got food for a second and they're like, oh shit, we're late.
Yeah. To fly there and back and do. I mean, first of all, I've told Katrina before the max people we can do in a day is three, because just talking to three different groups of people, you have to be on for that each one is a minimum of 2 to 3 hours. So you figure, you know, you're looking at six to, you know, somewhere in that 6 to 8 hours of communicating with three different types of people potentially or groups is already like taxing as fuck, right? So I've always told her, like, don't push us beyond three in a day.
And you typically have to travel to three different places. Yeah.
And especially where we were
for each person.
That was what was unique about this trip was normally we are somewhere already, right? Like we're in Austin for 4 or 5 days, we're in LA for 4 or 5 days, we're in somewhere for 4 or 5 days. This one was a day trip, and so to plan three people in a day was a day, man.
Yeah,
it was cool though, man.
I came home and she was like,
"Yeah, kudos to Katrina.
How was it?" Right? She wants to know how it went, and I was like, "Good, good." And she's like, and then she's like, "Do you not want to talk about it?" I'm like, "I mean, we can." I said, "I just, you know, if we get going into it," I was like, "You know how I get." And she's like, "Oh, I just want to make sure, you know, was it the trip worthwhile business wise? Was it business smart?" And I said, "No, absolutely, it was." She goes, "Well, you sound like you're not as excited." And I'm like, "Well, no, it was good. It was a good trip." She's like, "Well, was it a waste of time, wasn't it?" And like, so she keeps doing this to me.
Oh, no.
And I'm like, "Do you want to get into this or what?" And she's like, "Well, I mean, I just feel like," and you could tell she was getting like kind of upset about it, like, you know, because she works hard to make that happen, right? And then here I am like not valuing what she does. And so I get that. I'm putting this together, right? So I'm like, okay, you know, so I like light the joint. I'm like, "I'm going to have to smoke weed for this one because we're going to."
So, all right, we're going to get in.
So I go, you know.
So, babe, when I talk to you, I got to get
high. So I go, It's at the worst, I said, it's a, from a business standpoint, I said, at the worst, it's a wash with the potential of being really, really big, really good. And I said, but we've done this enough times now you know, that I'm just not overly excited about. She goes, well, I just feel like, you know, like when you got back recently from Austin and wherever else we just came back from, she's like, you just seem way more excited than this time. And I'm like, no, I think I'm just getting used to this now. It's like, you know, the first couple times we did this,
you also came back exhausted as fuck.
Well, and yeah. I explained that to her. I'm like, I'm exhausted. Yeah. I said, you gotta remember, like, this was probably one of the more exhausting days we've had to do. So, you know, I'm tired, I'm exhausted, I feel like I just want to crash. And I said, plus, you know, nothing has developed from this yet. So for all I know, we could all go our separate ways. Nothing happens with Univision. Nothing happens with Vinny. Yeah, like, you know, maybe nothing, we do anything with the Human Garage. Like, maybe nothing goes beyond what we just did yesterday. And for those reasons, it's at least a wash because it was good relations. It obviously gets us out there still.
Good content.
Yeah, good. What exactly? Good content. Oh, and I said to her, I said, you know, Human Garage guys, brilliant minds. I said, that's great. Always great for us boys to.
Yeah, we definitely learn stuff.
Right. Be communicating with other, you know, very intelligent, fitness, wellness-minded people. I said, so from a standpoint like that, if we're looking at it like a numbers that way, I'm like, okay, it's a wash right now, but it could be huge. And I said, I just don't get excited about that stuff until it happens. It's like, so yeah, no.
You're so jaded.
Right, yeah. So.
It's cool.
Yeah.
No, she was, but it ended up turning into an hour and a half conversation, so I was up till fucking 12:30 last night.
What a great trip, though. I mean, it was
as tired as we were. It was super fun,
dude. Univision, awesome.
Yeah, yeah.
That was great.
How about that studio?
Great recording envy. Studio. Loved it.
We all had envy on that.
But it was cool meeting, like, you know, we've done lots of podcasts, we've been on other shows, we've met lots of people, but it's always a treat to meet a genuine fan.
Yeah.
You know, and Liz was, she's a genuine fan. She's listened to
every episode,
every single episode. So when we're talking to her, like, she's asking questions and talking to us, and she knows the whole journey like that we've been through.
Specific things from episodes.
Which is really, cool. I really, really, really appreciate that when you find someone who does that, because, we do what we do, and we put a lot of our heart and soul into it. And when you see someone that it resonates with in a positive way.
Mm-hmm. Well,
it just feels really nice.
It's interesting to see what she's trying to do too, because, you know, I thought when we first got set up, like, I like, what are we going to do at Univision? Like, I can't speak Spanish. Like, this is not going to go well, right? But when I realize what she's trying to do and the battle that she's fighting right now, is that she sees what Mind Pump has done, the message that we're giving. She says that she feels like Univision and just most of the Spanish networks are behind in this message. Like, just no one's giving this message. They're like, she feels like they're 5-10 years behind us. Mm-hmm. And so she wants to kind of be that.
In general, it's just that community, the Latino community in general, is not.
Yeah, you brought up to her, like, with the sodas and obesity and diabetes. And
yeah, things. Like, if you look at, like, our closest, one of our, you know, closest neighbor, Mexico. If you look at the obesity epidemic there, you will see one of the fastest growth of obesity and just starkest contrast within a generation or two that you can see anywhere else. Part of it was the introduction of highly processed foods, of course, accessibility to foods, but then the processed foods to the point where soda, which was never consumed, like, you know, a couple generations ago, they didn't have soda. Now it's a staple with almost every meal.
Not just
they
regular soda either. This is like extra amounts of sugar in that soda.
It is, and diabetes has exploded there, and so they're just starting to learn about like nutrition and health because it was not really a concern before. The concerns before were very different, and you're just seeing this just rapid trend and change. And so she's really trying with her podcast to make. To convey the, like, proper good nutrition advice, good fitness advice. Yeah, so it's really cool.
Yeah, it's very cool.
I normally don't like to go somewhere where the host doesn't have headphones for us to, like, listen for feedback.
That got me. I was weirded out by that.
But I was surprised. I don't like that at all. But it wasn't bad with that.
No.
If that play the way they have that thing set up, it's so conversational. The way it's set up, it felt so easy to just kind
of
talk.
I'll give her props. I think she's been listening because of our style and like what we kind of try to coach other podcasts. Like, just start recording and let's just like flow. It was, she was recording everything before we even realized it. And I was like, ah,
that was awesome.
You're awesome.
That was awesome.
We're a bunch of assholes. And then, we always try and coach people.
Yeah, we can't help it.
I know I'm notorious for that one. Too.
Well, I mean,
I'm a bad habit. But you know what, though?
But we like to be coached too. There's
that's
definitely,
that's what we learned.
So I feel like, too, it's better. I'm glad you said that because I feel like I come from a good place when I do that. And I know I have a habit of doing that. It's not like I know more than you. It's that I appreciate someone sharing knowledge or information.
Dude,
that's
Ben Pack did that.
Yeah, right.
Ben Greenfield
is always dropping bombs.
Tom Bilyeu, you know, Mike Matthews, when we met with him.
I'm receptive to that.
Yeah, these are all people that have, like, we sat down and they just taught us things.
Right, so I feel the same way too. Yeah. Like, when we get into situations like that, it's not me, like, trying to be in control or tell someone what to do. It's just like, fuck, dude, this was a game changer for us. This has helped me out. When you do this, if you do this, it makes a big difference with your audience and it helps out. And so, I think for the most part, I feel like most people receive it. But I know sometimes I have to be aware of myself. I know I can come off like I'm telling you,
take it or leave it.
And I know that can be annoying because I know, like, I don't like. There's, I say this all the time to people that one of my biggest pet peeves is someone who's trying to tell you how to run a race that you're already beating them at. You know, it's like, so.
Oh my god,
it's so annoying, right? When you get
that way too often, though, I guess that's where the frustration comes.
Oh god, dude. Yeah.
Hey, but you know what though? Sometimes you learn something even from people like that.
Of course,
it's true. You know,
yeah. You can't be closed minded. You always have to be open minded.
No. You just want them to have the same attitude. That's all.
I just get quiet with people like that. When I'm like, oh, okay, yeah. I'm not normally a quiet guy, and if you cool. That should always be your red flag, though. What's going on in my?
Oh, you know what it reminds me of?
Because you got 5 downloads.
It's almost like the story that Vinny was telling us when we were meeting with him. Remember how he said when he was in the gym?
Oh yeah, yeah.
And there was that like kind of buff chick.
Yeah, yeah.
And she comes over, she's spotting him, and he just had shoulder surgery, and he's barely lifting the bar, and she's
totally
like
that, yeah.
Coaching him on how he should work out and what he needs to do with his diet, this and that. He's just like, yeah, okay, that's cool, whatever.
Yeah.
And she has no idea she's talking to like the celebrity.
That takes
trainer.
A lot. That takes a lot of humility to be able to do that. Not a lot of people.
Confident.
Yeah, you have a lot of humility, a lot of confidence to be able to let people kind of come in and say shit.
Dude, that happens to me all the time.
Yeah.
You know, like at Orange Theory, that girl coaching me on how to do a proper press with the TRX. And then
do people at the gym
even
tell
Ben
you
Pack is like, you know, coming at like my form for like hypertrophy training. I'm like, yeah, of course. You know, like bring, not like coach me, you know, it's all good, whatever. But it's like, I know, like, anyways, but you just have to kind of receive it, you know, you got to like realize that.
Absolutely.
Like, I'm humble and I, you know, I'm here to learn too, but I know a lot.
You haven't, that hasn't happened to you. That hasn't happened to you lately, has it? No one's done that lately, right? Lately.
Nobody stops you at the gym.
No. Like sometimes it's just weird how it randomly happens.
That would be
like
hilarious, right? Yeah. So walk over, correct your form
at the gym.
God. That'd be hilarious.
Hey, you should try a grip like this. Yeah. You know, one time there was a member doing I don't remember what it was. It was some exercise and the form was all fucked up when I was a trainer. Mm-hmm. And I walked over to him and I'm like, hey, you might want to try it this way. And I show him a different way of doing it. And he had broken English and he goes, you don't look like Arnold. And he turns around and does it his old way. I'm like, you motherfucker.
You sucker. Well, you know what I used to
you
get?
Don't look
when,
like
I, when I was competing, I was competing with all these. I was working out a lot and around a lot of these other competitors, you know. So they all look fucking great and awesome. And we'd work out. They would just, let's do this. I want to do this for that. And I'm like, oh, God, for this. They tell for what reason and stuff. I'm like, no, I'm going to do this. And then they all wonder, like, why I didn't want to work out. Like, everyone's just like, hey, what day are you working out? What time are you do this? I'm like, nah, it's cool. I'm doing my own thing, you know. And I just don't like having to explain myself every time. I'm like, well, this is what I'm doing, okay? It's like, if you want to join me, you can join me. But you're not going to convince me why you want to go do this exercise for the fucking reasons you want to go do them for, because we're not going to get into this.
Yeah. Dude, speaking of working out, you know what I'm starting to see, which is a good thing? And I try not to get irritated with it. It's because it's actually a good thing.
Huh.
Are you guys seeing what I'm seeing on Instagram and social media right now with a lot of these like fitness gurus who are now starting to promote exercise frequency or workout frequency, where they're like full body workouts,
spontaneously all of a sudden.
You mean Dr. Obvious?
No, yeah, there's Dr. Obvious and there's two Dr. Obviouses and Dr. Integrity is the other one. who now are promoting like full body workouts, and this may be more better.
I like Dr. I like you giving Jim Dr. Integrity.
That's great.
So we got Jim. Jim will be we'll call Jim Dr. Integrity.
Dr. Integrity.
And then we'll call Muscle PhD. We'll call him Dr.
Dr. Obvious.
Dr. Obvious. Dr. Obvious and Dr. Integrity.
He's been posting.
Can you have the designer create some fucking characters?
Those are great characters.
Please,
waiting to happen.
Yes, yeah. Please tell me 100%. Those are great characters. Yeah. A lab coat. Dr. Obvious wears a lab coat, and Dr. Integrity
has glasses and is
tatted up.
Yes, dude. Please.
Yeah, because like now it's like all of a sudden I'm reading like
all in fun for all you fucking people that are fucking bitching. I know.
Fucking whatever army hashtag. You know what I mean?
Listen, here's the thing. When we were first started Mind Pump and we were promoting full body workouts and frequency, we had a lot of resistance from this world. We did. We got into debates and discussions about, no, it's better to do it the body part split way. And well, if your way is better, then why are all the bodybuilders training this way and this and that and the other? And we were arguing with a lot of these people, but they're starting to come around. Yeah. Part of it is because the science is really starting to catch up. I don't know how many studies now that they've done that have demonstrated that if you compare two workouts with the same total volume, but this one over here has more frequency, in other words, they split up the volume, it's just superior. Mm-hmm. There's like several studies now that are showing this. So that's part of the reason. And the other part of the reason is, I think because of the internet, because we're not the only one we didn't invent training this way. It was the way people trained before steroids. But I think with the internet and the way information spreads, people are sharing more of their anecdote, and more people are trying to work out this way.
Yeah.
To the point now where I'm seeing...
Well, you're seeing it in like magazines and everything too.
Your
T Nations, your even Men's Health like is talking about these...
We know
like,
they're mind publishers.
Abandon the body part split and all this kind of stuff. I'm like, oh, really?
I know.
Really?
I'm going to call T Nation out on the show.
Why?
Because I'm just going to say it.
Like, but we like them.
No, we love them.
Yeah, they're great.
Reveal yourself, bro.
Where are you getting your sources,
say what's up, dude. Let's go grab lunch. Man,
there's a big curtain.
Yeah,
pull it back and
reveal yourself.
There's Mind Pump.
It's like a hologram. Yeah, Mind Pump. Yeah.
Let's kick it, dude. Like I like a lot of shit you say,
you
man.
Should, yeah.
Most of the stuff that they put
team up. You know what I mean?
Most of the stuff they put out is awesome. One of the few sources.
A lot of it is. Yeah.
Yeah.
Most if we do it right, instead of you guys dropping stuff right after we talk about it, we can just collaborate and we can drop it together.
Adam, Adam's such a dick. But anyway, I'm glad.
It's so fun.
I just call it how I see it.
It's so fun.
I'm glad, though, that this information is now starting to get out because it's better. People are getting in better shape.
Well, that's the point of why we're doing this.
Here's what I'm waiting for. Yeah. Here's what I'm waiting for. I'm gonna do the clap. You know, people get annoying when they talk.
Here's what I'm doing.
Who, if you knew, do you know that?
You ever see when people argue?
That was on like maybe what movie was that with Eddie Murphy where he played all the different characters?
You know, when someone's arguing
Hercules,
and they're trying to make
Hercules.
No, not that. But we're like, let me tell you. You know,
let me tell you. Something.
Anyway, here's what I can't wait for. I cannot wait for variations of trigger sessions to start getting fucking put out there and for people not to call them trigger sessions. I can't wait. It's already happening a little bit. I'm seeing people talk about and reference different things.
Maximizers.
Yeah, whatever.
Yeah.
But it's a trigger session.
Molecule
we
session.
We did it first.
You know what?
Or first-ish.
I think we need to make
maybe
sure.
Maybe someone else did it first. I don't know.
Charging.
I don't know about it, though.
Charging session.
I don't know. Do you? So, not like that.
You know, Rich Piana talked about feeder sessions. Someone told me about a long time ago, so I don't know if that's similar. But definitely the way we talk about trigger sessions, the way we present it,
I doubt Rich Piana had the same science to support his purposes.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe. I don't know. Yeah. But anyway, I can't wait because I guarantee you that's going to be a thing everybody's going to start doing soon as well.
Yeah.
And we electrify session.
It has molecules.
I think that and then I'm calling and waiting for the revolt on the IIFYM pendulum to swing back. Because it's I still think it's on the rise. You know, more and more people are finding it, and it's working. And absolutely, definitely.
So you think it's gonna swing so hard? Everyone's
You
know, what's interesting to me. Vinny was talking about with CrossFitters and how much like they're seeking out like donuts and all these like high sugar type foods and stuff because they're so depleted, right? It makes so much sense to me, like, why that's part of the culture. You know, it's ingrained. It's like deadlifts, donuts, all this kind of stuff.
There's literally 8 million IIFYM tags, And the very first picture that opens up when I, the very top, top post is a cookie butter Oreo cookies. Yeah. So it will, it's going to swing. And I know like the ones that like to support it are like, well, that's not what it stands for. And you know, you got to count the fiber still and you got net carbs and you know, you mean
eating healthy?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. Mm. So I know there's camps that like to buy at the end of the day,
Here's the trend that I'll predict right now that I've said before. I'm going to say it again so that people fucking solidify that we said it. You are going to see a trend that it's because we've already seen the demonization of carbohydrates, fats. Just wait. The protein one is coming. 100%.
Oh, that's guaranteed. A good call. That's a good call.
Guarantee you it's going to be like, oh no, eating too much protein, which, you know, if you eat a shit ton of it, it's definitely not the greatest, but you're going to see protein fasting become a thing.
The argument that I had with that, and I had this with you when you first brought that up almost fucking 2 years ago or whatever, is we're still, it's barely hitting mainstream now that like you're seeing, you know, Nestle adding it to their things. Like, so
that's how I know the backlash is coming. When I see like high protein Coke or whatever, then I know the backlash is coming.
Oh, see, that's
it's like when your parents know your favorite bands, like you're not cool anymore.
I think the opposite. I think that
there's an analogy
when I see companies doing it like that, it tells me that it's going on a run for a while. If it was a stock, I would be telling people to buy right now.
Here's why I think
buy the protein stock.
Right yeah, now. Well, it's already high though. That's what I'm saying. Like,
oh, it's high, but it's gonna get higher.
It may be. Remember, you want to buy low and sell high. So yeah, high.
Well, you would have bought. Okay, in a perfect world, when you and I argued about it 2 years ago, you would have bought when I said.
Yeah. Then maybe it's gone up. Yeah, maybe.
Oh, 100% it has.
But I definitely think the fall is gonna be. It's gonna be interesting because I can already see it with because the popularity of fasting and the popularity of ketogenic diets. The reason being is both of which cite science that show health benefits.
Yeah.
And some of the health benefit that comes from those, people need to know, is the avoidance of protein. Because you get autophagy or accelerated rates of autophagy, which is programmed cell death, or getting rid of waste or whatever in the body. That is accelerated because you're avoiding both carbohydrates and fats because carbohydrates and proteins, not fats. So both of those citing that science. So that's one of the things that's going to fuel the whole, oh, you know, you need to avoid protein sometimes and protein fasting is a good thing. And you know, you don't have to have high protein, everything.
What do you think about like intermittent keto diet? Like,
well, cyclical,
right?
That's like,
I feel like that's what it's going to evolve to.
Maybe. Oh, you think so?
Yeah.
I came up with
because
a diet.
It's like, I mean, it's such a hard diet to maintain for a long time.
Well, we're watching, you know, I mean, there's the, we, and we called that too, was the keto crave. I mean,
that's why I think it's already losing momentum.
We saw that. Remember when we said about supplements with it? Look at all the, I mean, that's,
everybody's putting ketones and everything.
Oh, yeah.
Now.
Keto supplements like are crazy. Well, I bet you, I would love actually to look at that. We should look that up. Yeah. I'd like to see how much
keto
it's been
cookies,
on the, it's been on the rise
shakes.
In the last 6 months to a year.
So yeah. I came up with a diet idea the other day just for shits and giggles that I 100%.
You did. Wait. Before you share this, you did, or is this one of those things where I shared this and then you turn around?
No, I did.
Okay, let's hear this.
I did for sure.
Remember what I said? Let's hear.
So right now, tell me what you said.
No. Let's hear this.
Let's hear this.
This is a rebrand.
Justin knows, bro. He knows. He'll know.
No. Rebrand. Something that I would never put out.
Okay.
Because it's not. It would be like it's a hook. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But if I had less integrity, let's say I was Dr. Integrity. If I was that guy, I could fucking put this together and sell the fuck out of it because it's got a tagline on it, it's got a hook, and I could definitely take science
juicy
to support it. I could get some science to make it sound good.
What's that?
I'll call it the every other day diet. You don't eat whatever you want, just eat every other day. Fast 3 days a week for maximal health and whatever. Easy. I could fucking write a whole book on that shit. You guys are pissed off I said it because you want to make that book now.
Fast,
I know.
Fast 3 days a week.
Yeah.
And then eat everything every other day.
The every other day diet. Every other day diet. I know that I would sell millions just to the title alone. It would be controversial. He says people should need every day. And I'd be like, well, fasting actually has been.
It has nothing to do with what I was thinking. That is a clever idea.
Eat every other
day. That is clever.
I know it is.
But we both know that wouldn't be ideal to teach people that.
No, that's why I wouldn't do it.
Yeah,
like I said, if I was Dr. Integrity,
a lot of, red tape.
I would do it.
Red flags.
But I have too much integrity to do it. Yeah. But
maybe we could sell the idea to Dr. Integrity.
become partners with him?
Yes. Now you're thinking.
There's passion behind
it. Because it is your idea. I mean, let's build the IP around it, buddy. Yeah.
Listen, watch someone come out with that shit now. Like 2 years from now, there's going to be a book.
Who was it? Jason Alan Scott? He was talking about like stealing the whale blubber diet or whatever.
He's making a joke about it?
Yeah, the Eskimo diet.
Eskimo diet.
He wanted to take the keto diet way back when we were talking about it originally. And he's like,
because that's how Inuits eat.
Yeah.
And he's like, you know,
brilliant
breakfast, seal blubber. Lunch.
I wanted to do whale liver. And I would do my diet. And mine's probably less marginal.
Don't say it.
What's that?
Don't say what you're going to say then. If you're going to do it,
yeah, it's
don't give
that,
away the idea.
It's something that I would share it with people. Because you know what? If somebody else came up with it, I think it should be shared. I was starting to mess with it when I was tracking and it just fell off. Me tracking and getting ready for this Olympia weekend that we didn't end up going to. And that was rotating your foods and writing a diet that's more about getting the what you need versus not like restricting.
Don't
like,
tell everybody.
Right. He's already talked about this on the show.
Yeah, I've already mentioned this before. It's not like a big secret.
So it's not
seek out.
Instead of being restrictive.
Yeah.
There are no restrictions.
No restrictions.
Aim for these things.
Right, and it would be more like that. And what would take the time
in
to do
rotation?
That?
Like I need this.
Right. Would to go through.
What's the opposite of the word diet? That's what it should be called.
Backwards. Yeah. Right. Tied.
Oh yeah.
Tied. Not that literally.
Oh. The tide diet.
Wow.
Just boom.
Follow this tide.
This sounds like detergent. I don't want to eat that.
Yeah, no, it is detergent, right? Yeah. No, I think that would be, it would take a little bit of time and thought to actually draw it all the way up to make sure it was well put together. But I think it would be a really cool strategy for people, and it's kind of how I coach people anyways.
I want to do, have you hit your micros, bro?
Micros?
Yeah, micros. Just the all focused on micros.
We could do a knockoff on it.
If it fits my micros.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's all just nutrients?
Just nutrients and minerals. That's it.
People like
what the fuck?
Let's just take vitamins then.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
I lost 10 pounds.
Man, you lose a lot of weight. Yeah. It was hard coming out of that.
Stare at the sun.
What do you think some of all the diets and stuff that we've seen, what do you think some of the worst, like, gimmicky fucking things that we've seen? I've seen the celery diet before, cabbage diet.
They're always on some Good Morning America bullshit.
Isn't that crazy to think about that? Like, some of the worst ones are the ones that get the most traction.
Bro, here's the formula.
The cookie diet. Remember that one?
See, here's the formula to selling a diet book and making millions of dollars. Make it crazy as fuck. That's it. Make it crazy and name it something that's ridiculous, like the pizza diet. Guaranteed hella people will buy.
This is why your idea is actually really good.
I know it is.
Yeah,
I know it is. I just have too much integrity.
We can't do it with... I feel like we could do it
the
with
every
integrity.
Other day diet would sell so much, right? Bro.
We just got to caution people.
And think of the science I could put in there. That's all fasting science.
If you have no morals, DM us.
And I'd crush people in debate. So I would go on a show, a fitness show, and they'd be like, how could you tell people to eat every other day? And I'd be like, do you think our ancestors ate every single day?
Yeah.
This is how we evolved to eat. I could sell it.
Yeah.
I just won't do it because it's bad. I have too much integrity, like I said.
Right.
It's not like...
So out of that, you just got closed.
I'm
slowly closing myself over here on how we could do it right.
There's so many dollars.
Because let's talk about the bad of that.
How about the don't...
If you're being...
The don't eat every day diet. Oh. See, now...
Don't eat.
You can fast one day a week.
That sounds negative, though. Yeah, like,
Well, we know.
Your other one was bad.
I mean, I know how.
How about the one day a week diet? Something like that. You know
there is one like that, actually. There is a diet. There is a diet, actually. And you know what? The every other day thing. Okay, this diet, actually, now
like
that you said.
I like the every other day.
There is a diet that actually promotes this eating once every 4 days or something, and you can just go to town. On that fourth day, but it's every.
It's here's why it's a brilliant diet.
Binge eating. Yeah,
exactly. Here's why it's a brilliant diet. This is why it's so awesome. It's controversial. It gives people the permission to eat whatever the fuck they want on the days that they eat. People love that. Like, you know what? I think I have enough, you know, willpower to not eat 2 days a week or whatever.
Let's talk about the psychology.
But if I could eat as much as I want on the other day.
We got to highlight the negatives.
That's why I hate the fucking term cheat day, too, cheat meal.
And that's all they focus on the entire day. They're just like, they're horny for that day to come.
Cheat meal.
Here's another diet we could invent. It could be a diet that has the approach like this. you know the story. Like, you get caught smoking cigarettes by your parents or whatever. Your dad takes you in the garage. Yeah. Your dad takes you in the garage and makes you smoke the whole pack, so you get sick.
That's so bad.
And then you never want to smoke cigarettes again because now you've associated that horrible feeling.
You ate a pizza. Now you have to eat like 20 pizzas.
Maybe we construct a diet where people list their foods that are their weaknesses, and we go, okay, in day one, you're going to eat.
It's called exposure therapy.
Yeah. You're going to eat as much cake as you can, or eat cake until you throw up.
Until you throw up.
And you do this with all the foods you want to eat. And so people are going to be like, oh, cool.
Yeah.
I get to do that. And that might actually work.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
That's a horrible sound.
I've already come up with two diets now.
Yeah. I can't believe how many people say Gary Vee in the top five for the most. If I said,
are you talking about your post?
Yeah, the start.
Well, first you have to enlighten the audience.
Unless he's like,
so I did a post.
Marketing.
I did a post. Yeah, pick your starting five. If you're building the ultimate successful business, who's your starting five?
And who are the five people you would have?
Yeah, that you'd have run this sucker with you, right? And a lot of people have put Gary Vee. And I feel like it's all these young guys. A lot of these young guys.
He comes across as like
I mean,
a super business guy, and he is excellent. But I don't think he's been around long enough to be in the same category of people like Elon Musk or
Oprah Winfrey
or any of them.
That's why I said I don't even know, and that's what I was trying to think.
But that's their exposure. Like, you ask a young kid. You know,
well, he's just popular right now.
Like, they're not even gonna think Oprah, not knowing that that woman is not only a billionaire on her own, created out of nothing, but she also created many, many, many multi millionaires on her own herself. Yeah. She created that.
One of the best communicators out there.
Just a brilliant woman.
Yeah, my list was, my thought process was, I was looking for brilliant minds. You know. Work ethic, and then influencers to sell the fucker, right? So Rock and Oprah are who's selling my whatever it is, whatever we're doing,
right.
They're moving it, right? You know what I'm saying? With their power, their influence, that was my thought process on them. And then Elon Musk, Bill Gates, and Jeff Bezos, I feel like you're talking about the billionaire, brilliant minds at building businesses and industries, right? I think that
I like how my mind pissed a couple people off.
You know, it's funny, and I love that you fired back, because it's like, of course,
it makes sense.
Because you say Donald Trump, everybody's gonna be like, oh my god, because of the politics thing. But it's like, take out that he was a president.
That's the thing you have to take
that out, and he's one of the most respected businessmen in the world.
In history.
Yeah.
Forget about like that's the thing. Like, I'm not looking at people and thinking like who I like and who I don't like.
Right. Okay? Or this isn't about whose values you're aligned with.
No.
What I'm saying?
Like, I'm looking at pure business person, and Donald Trump, whether you like him or not, okay, and I'm not the biggest fan of Donald Trump. I make that well known. But whether you like him or not, this motherfucker has done some crazy shit at crazy odds several times. In business, the guy went bankrupt and came back and became a billionaire again after creating, you know, out of, you know, a little bit of money, turning it into massive amounts, employing all these people. But then here's the part that's crazy. In this story, people are going to tell for the rest of American history. Here's a guy that nobody wanted to win the presidential election. Nobody. Nobody wanted him to win. Republicans didn't like him either.
Yeah.
A lot of them are kissing his ass now, but nobody wanted him to win.
Yeah. Right.
And he goes through, and so to the point where he was made fun of by everybody on TV, laughing whenever he'd even say he was going to run.
Yeah, media is against him, everybody.
And he fucking wins. It's like, this guy is, I would hate to go against him for anything.
So what do you think?
It's pretty crazy.
It's just crazy. I would hate to go against. He's like,
against like every odd possible,
dude. It's a crazy, story.
What do you have to say though about? Isn't it weird? Okay, so I don't know how many comments it's up to now. I think it's up to like 70 something on my page or whatever. So tons of people have already started to engage and do this. The two most, consistent comments that people are saying is either one, commenting and giving you shit about the Trump, which that's one thing.
Sure.
The other thing is the Gary Vee. So. And both of those, I feel like, are heavily influenced by social media. And so...
Well, that's the thing I said, because he's like, you know, people are having an issue with Trump. Trump is hated a lot now because he's in politics. Before that, a lot of people didn't talk shit about him, and he was... everybody seemed to like him. I think it's when you go into politics, more stuff comes out.
Enough people liked him to fucking vote him in as president, so he's not that hated.
I don't know, man. Like I said, it's crazy. There's a lot of these
people. My point, though, is that like it's crazy how much social media influences everybody. That's the two. Those are the two most consistent things that you're seeing on my post right now is these kids that actually think that Gary V is even in the conversation of the top five, and that Donald Trump is unbelievably, how could he be? So that to me is so polarizing right there. You would put Gary V in your top five right here, and you would actually, and some people would actually argue and debate the Donald Trump thing, and it's like, what is feeding that?
Yeah.
What is feeding the mind?
Perception, dude.
It's all perception, right? It's like, and that couldn't be such a distorted perception right there. The fact that you think, what's Gary V worth? 50 mil?
Yeah.
I mean, but it's not only like that's not respectable or anything like that, but it's like, and it's
just you have to have
long
history.
Didn't he inherit a $4 million wine business?
I don't know.
He took it from a took a $4 million wine business to a $60 million wine business, but he inherited a $4 million one. I mean, not to take anything from somebody.
No, there's no doubt he's a badass.
And anybody that's built a million dollar business knows that the difference between going from $0 to $4 million and going from $4 million to $50 million is a whole different monster.
That's the thing.
And most guys that have actually done this will tell you that going from 5 to 50 million is actually easier than the 0 to 5. 90% of businesses do not make it past their first year. Mm-hmm. So fucking A, getting from 0 to 4 million is the real win. That's the first big fucking,
you know,
not to take, and I know I got a lot of Gary V fucking lovers out there. I love the guy. He's fucking badass.
Yeah.
But I'm just talking about the perception that we have, that the fact that many people would put Gary V on there as their top 5 if you're going to build a business.
No, I'll stand behind that. Like that 0 to 4, man, like that's what impresses me the most in you know, when I'm thinking about like business people are like, who started it from absolutely nothing,
right?
It that is such like an accomplishment. I can't even, like, I know firsthand like what this is, just to get into, like, you know, the 100,000 into this, it's just so many odds stacked against you.
According to Wikipedia, V is worth 160 million.
I've read 160, I've read 60, and I've read 10. So
he wrote it.
Nonetheless, though, still not to knock 160 million. Still, it doesn't scratch. It doesn't blow it.
Here,
it's not even close to fucking Bezos, Bill Gates, Elon Musk.
He's definitely a hustler and he's killing it.
Yeah, you
know? He's definitely doing all
Mad
that.
Mad respect, love the dude. But what it is that he's probably one of the best right now at communicating to the millennials and the younger generation. And what is the youngest one? Z?
Yeah, he lives in that environment. He lives on the social media format. He's one of the forward-thinking business people right now. So I'll give him all the credit day with that.
Here's something else you want to consider. However hard it is to go from 0 to a million or to 4 million, it is extremely, if not more rare and difficult to go from millionaire to billionaire. There are very, very few billionaires in the world.
Yeah.
It's very, so, you know, someone, you make $100 million, you're obviously an incredible success.
Mm-hmm.
But to take $100 million and turn it into a billion, well, now you're a genius. Very, very few people who've done that themselves. Typically what happens is they'll, like if Gary Vee has kids that then become, and they develop these dynasties that then turn into billions.
Mm-hmm.
But you've got some guys who start with zero or a little bit of money and then turn it into billion. That's a whole nother level.
That's insane. No. And that was my point. But I think that, don't you find that fascinating, though, that when you look at the feed and you pay attention to like what everyone's saying and commenting, you know, to think that you had a bunch of people that were fighting you on the Trump thing, you know, and I don't know, what's Trump's net worth?
He's a billionaire.
Yeah, right. He's for sure billionaire,
yeah,
right?
He's a billionaire.
Right. So, yeah, I mean, you got someone that is a billionaire and been killing it in business for many, many years. And to argue that is crazy to me, right? Especially if you're putting people like Gary Vee in your top five. So I think that's fascinating. And you know, I'm a fan of both. I think they're both badass dudes, and it's just a fun discussion to have. And what I find interesting is the perspectives that people have. I think that's really cool. I think but it's also very dangerous and scary to think that how easily
it's always been that way.
How easily, like, well, yeah, but it's not like to the level it is right now. The way social media has influenced people now is nowhere near what media was 10 years ago with TV and radio. We're influencing people way more at a faster rate and a larger amount
of course,
due to social media than what we were. So that didn't exist 10 years ago.
Well, I mean, what I mean is
we're playing a new game.
What I mean is, you know, false perceptions. Ever since, I mean, it's always been around, but especially when media has existed, which has been around for a while now, where people will say something like, think about it this way, like, even today, you can be a social media celebrity. You could be someone on Instagram that's got like tons and tons of followers. You walk the streets and you get recognized like crazy. You could be a celebrity that's from the 90s that people don't really remember anymore, at least millennials don't. They don't recognize you, but you're worth way more fucking money. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of these Instagram celebrities that have like tons of followers, whatever. They don't make shit.
And I'll tell you what, to call myself out, you know, you could argue one of my five by putting The Rock in there, right? Because he's not fucking, I don't think he's worth $1 billion.
No, I think you put him there for his social media power.
He's just going to keep rising.
Exactly. Yeah, I'm looking like
he's a monster.
I'll tell you why I picked him. It's my heart pick, right? So he's my man crush in the first place. So that's definitely a heart pick alone. Yeah. But I mean, they've said that this guy could run for president one day. And one day in the near future because of his likability. Mm-hmm. So he's on the rise. I think that if I'm looking at my business and I'm marketing it, selling it, like him and Oprah are my two that are going to move my company, right? Mm-hmm. Like I have my other three as my geniuses behind it.
Yeah, I had Dana White as one of those for me.
Right. That's your. I thought that was very suspect of you.
Really?
I let you go on that one. Yeah. I was gonna get after you. I'd like you to explain yourself.
I'll explain
mainly. Explain yourself, son.
Promotional,
I actually think Dana White is kind of a dumb dick, dude.
Yeah. Bro, he took a company that was bleeding. And he fucking made it crush.
You think so?
He's a big part of it.
Yeah.
He's about 3% part of it, actually.
Well, the work that he did.
This is what I think.
I mean, the Fertittas are the brains behind the whole thing. Definitely. But
so, well, there you go then. That's enough said. Yeah, enough said right there.
Dana White's interesting character. I could see where the rationale.
That was okay. Let me retract my. What did I say? Dumb dick. Did I fucking throw something?
That.
That's me stirring shit up, right? Yeah. So, I like Dana White also, but I'm just saying, like on that,
that was more of a fun pick. I'm kind of in agreement with you. He's not like a super powerhouse in comparison to like some other picks that I had, but you know, I liked him as like the wild card in the group.
That is a wild card.
You know what I mean? To get like more exposure and get things out there and like move and shake things up and be sort of the pit bull of the group. But yeah, I liked I liked Oprah, of course. Like that was like one of my top picks too, for sure. Elon Musk. Who else did I get? I got Mark Cuban in there.
Oh, I liked your Mark Cuban pick. So you made up for that.
Yeah, because I mean, Mark Cuban.
You get minus points for the Dana White, but the Mark Cuban pick, I would like that.
He's
Mark
a deal maker, man. That guy is savage. Dude. I love you know, watching what he does and
brilliant businessman. Yeah. Brilliant businessman.
He just sees things like, you know, he sees trends and he sees these things and he just makes things happen, man. So he was definitely a top pick for me.
I put down, because obviously it had to be people who are alive. Yeah. You can't pick.
Oh, because Margaret Thatcher would be in my
car.
Yeah,
I would love.
Yeah, that'd be awesome.
Of course.
Yeah.
For women,
you ever
watch her videos of her debating in Parliament?
She is like a gangster.
Like, she used to fucking destroy people.
Yeah.
In debates and like, just sharp.
So, yeah, no. Definitely my style, for sure. Yeah. That 100%. She would be CEO of my company. That would be, I could do all time, like, I'm such a fan of Margaret Thatcher, and I think that. No matter what, too, I called out people that didn't have any women in there, and I'm like, how can you not have a powerhouse woman on your top five team? Like, I just feel like you have to have that. I feel like if you're going to build the most ultimate business, right, the biggest business in the world, like, you got to have one powerhouse woman.
I would argue, maybe not so much now moving forward, but definitely, you know, in the past, even if you go back, you know, 20 years or so, that some of these powerhouses, these female powerhouses, I would even, for example, Oprah, I would even suggest that she's top, because you consider the things that the odds that were against her, especially when she first started. You know, considering the fact that she's a woman, that she's a minority, those two factors, but also the poor, she's not the super attractive, you know, it's not like she had her sex appeal that was selling her.
Yeah.
In fact, she was told by people that she could never do it because you're not attractive. You know, here she just did it on sheer...
She defied all odds. Yeah. She did
not only defied it, but fucking crushed it. And then she finds talent and turns them into mega.
Turns them into gold.
Like Dr. Oz, Dr. Phil, like those are her dudes.
Well, and her vision to start her own network and do her, I mean, she did so many things right. She has incredible vision. So
ridiculous. Yeah. Like you're talking about a genius that I think is among the best ever, honestly.
Yeah. For sure.
No, I mean, if she were like a dude, I mean, what would she be doing now? I mean, consider, like I said, like all the things that were against her, especially when she was doing it back in the 70s and 80s.
Did you go through some of these? I was going through and like, I just chuckled at some of them, the ones. I mean, people put
like. There's like Jay Cutler in there.
Yeah, somebody put Jay Cutler.
Like he makes really good subs, man.
Yeah, I was like. Yeah.
For a bodybuilder, he's pretty good. He's a pretty, very, very smart businessman for a bodybuilder in that world. Which I don't think is a hard
one. I don't know.
You know who are brilliant in that world? If you want to talk about brilliant business people in the world of bodybuilding, fitness, whatever.
Like Joe Weider or something. Yeah,
the Weider brothers.
Yeah, okay, there you go. Like if you want to talk business, you want to talk about. Yeah. And even them, I wouldn't put them in the list, but they're like, you know, for the business inside of fitness.
They invented it, dude.
Yeah, no, they did. They did.
Think about how brilliant, by the way, the Weider fucking brothers were. They single-handedly made bodybuilding a thing.
Yeah.
Created magazines to number one.
Wow, somebody's
not to make money off magazines.
Someone's literally questioning Oprah right now.
Oh my God.
What?
Oh yeah. God. Get out of here. Idiots.
Idiots. I was like, how could you question Oprah? It's not even.
But I was saying about the Weider brothers, they created
Oprah
these magazines. These magazines they created to sell their athletes and their supplements. And then ended up selling magazines as well. Brilliant, brilliant men in that world. I don't think there's anybody. You know who else is really smart in that whole world? Brilliant, Bill Phillips.
Oh, I thought you were going to say Arnold.
Well,
Bill Phillips.
Well, Bill Phillips was a marketing genius.
Genius.
Yeah, marketing genius for sure.
He took EAS, which was shit when he took it over.
Yeah.
And turned it into.
A lot of people don't know that a lot of successful fitness businesses now modeled a lot of what EAS did. And
he reinvented the whole like the body for life challenge. That's his deal.
And they are actually up there still with one of the most successful supplement companies. And you don't see them anywhere. You don't see them on TV. You don't see advertising. They don't sponsor any bodybuilding athletes. None of that bullshit. And they, from a dollar year over year, they are one of the most successful supplement companies
still
today.
To this day.
And you know why? Because they had the one, and you can tell that this, and this is the vision of a true businessman or woman, and their company is like right now. You got everybody that's all trying the latest this, that, whatever. They were working on forging relationships with companies like Costco, you know. And when you get your brand in somewhere
mainstream,
like mainstream, game over.
Yeah, it's over.
Game over.
I remember
like,
reading.
You don't even need to come up with the latest, greatest.
Everybody had an EAS fucking, you know, bag.
So I remember reading Muscle Media 2000, which was their magazine. People don't realize this. All these magazines really were created to advertise to you the supplements that funded these magazines, as well as other supplements. But it was like advertising, but information. This is how much they skewed people's perceptions of what was good for muscle building or not. So I'd read these magazines, and there would be like, new study shows how vanadyl sulfate increases insulin sensitivity, burns body fat. Now, at the time, EAS, vanadyl sulfate was one of those V2 something. It was one of their top supplements. Yeah. So there were articles on creatine. There were articles on glutamine, because that was their other big seller.
So brilliant.
Articles on... Now, whey protein was not popular.
They created the game, bro.
They created whey protein was Ultimate Nutrition. Remember Ultimate Nutrition? Was it Ultimate Nutrition or Designer Protein? That's it. Excuse me. Designer Protein was the first big whey protein. Do you remember that?
Not only do I remember
that,
I worked in a factory that actually was scooping that into the bottles.
Ooh. Of Designer.
So I work. Yeah, this gives me my so early years. Of how skeptical I was about supplements. I was skeptical about supplements before I even understood them, because I was a kid, 15, 16 years old, working in a mixing factory for the as a summer job. And, you know, when we first started, we were just kind of cleaning and doing stuff. And then we worked into actually assembly line shit, and then working the hopper and doing this stuff. So I was responsible for filling these jugs up of these massive, massive things of protein. And the amount of stuff that got like mixed, or actually, it was like there's no regulation. So it's about speed. It's about speed and cleanliness and getting it quick. Like that, it's not about, oh, whoops, that's like 1.5 or an, oh, who cares? You know, moving along. You know, yeah. So we used to do creatine and we used to do designer whey protein powder.
Do you guys remember designer? That was the first like whey that people really bought.
Yeah.
And I know Dan Duquesne, who was Bill Phillips' like buddy, was the big guy behind it. Bill Phillips drove a lot of what you see now. In fact, I will venture to say the Weider brothers invented the supplement market in terms of like muscle building, fat loss. They were kind of the ones that pioneered how you sold it. Then Bill Phillips took it to the modern.
You know who would be awesome to talk to about this? When we get, remember
Dr.
Doug,
Andy Galpin?
Yes.
Yeah.
So he's already
like a wealth of knowledge.
He's coming here.
Yeah.
So, okay. Yeah. So Andy's getting up here. Oh, God, what did he say? I don't remember what I was just talking to him. It's, I think it's the 1st of October, somewhere around there, Doug. But remember, let's remember to talk about this topic with him because he's one of the guys that we've met recently that blew me away on his level of knowledge in this area. That,
yeah, he knows the whole history.
Of, yeah, so he would be fun to talk to and actually speculate some of the stuff that we're talking about.
No, if you look at, because this is something that I find extremely fascinating because I was so into this world and so into supplements. And you saw Bill Phillips create kind of the modern supplement way. He was the first guy to create a supplement company that really made a shit ton of fucking money.
Mm-hmm.
Then you had Muscle Tech. Muscle Tech really came in and started, they changed things up a little bit and they sold a shit ton.
Well, they were the masters of the loading of fucking creatine.
So they
created Cell Tech, which ends up being like all the flavored.
They didn't invent that though. That was EAS. EAS had phosphagen.
Yeah, phosphagen and the HP. Yeah, no, yeah, no.
They were the first ones to talk about it. And Muscle Tech went on to, and then Muscle Tech took it and got bodybuilders.
What Muscle Tech did very well is they, and what phosphagen HP didn't have or do, they had just a plain raw. When they went to Muscle Tech, then it was this flavored shit that you drank and you got like 600 calories of sugar or whatever it was in addition to creatine. So, and it was all
dextrose.
These, yeah, and you were trying to gain weight. So, no fucking shit, put some weight on you.
Well, so when creatine
was brilliant,
when creatine,
I don't know how many jugs of that shit I bought.
You're right. Because when creatine was first really promoted and sold, which you can thank EAS for that. When creatine was first sold, and that's what made them so big, by the way, because creatine actually works, right? When they were being sold, they used to tell you, theoretically, and by the way, this is not something that does anything for you. This was completely one of those things that is fucking invented by the supplement industry to sell more product. Dan Duquesne wrote an article about how insulin spiking or spiking your insulin will drive more or shuttle more amino acids, nutrients, whatever, into muscle cells because that's what insulin kind of does. So he's like, oh, you know what you do? Take dextrose with creatine and that should work. And so EAS actually told people this is an advanced way of taking creatine is to take dextrose or drink grape juice.
I used to mix it in orange juice all the time as a kid.
And then juice. You're right. Then you had Muscle Tech come on and say, "Oh, it's already in there."
Yeah.
And oh my God, that made me nauseous.
Or not orange juice. Orange juice was what you not to mix it.
No,
with.
No.
It was grape juice. It was grape juice. Grape juice. What we put it in, and orange juice something to do with the. What was it with the citrus?
Acidity.
The acidity from the.
It converted creatine to like a byproduct that was bad for you, but. Yeah, it was grape juice because grape juice is so high in the glycemic index.
Right, it was super high in sugar.
Yeah. Right, so that was what they recommended. Then Muscle Tech comes out. And then the next kind of revolution that I can remember in the supplement world, which was a blip. It was a huge blip because it went up, spiked, lots of popularity, then it dropped.
The androgens?
Yes, it was when it was the legality of because
I took all those too, dude.
Because it was gray market.
The chewable ones, stick on your tongue ones, the spray, the fucking.
I'm talking about
every pill, horse pills.
Androstenedione.
Yeah.
Which EAS, EAS was one of the first ones, right? Because they sold it.
That was over the counter, right?
It was all over the counter. Yeah. Because remember Mark McGuire was caught taking it?
Mm-hmm.
Then you had the designer steroids. And one of the first ones was, what was it by Halidrol was one of them. Superdrol was another one.
Yeah.
These were the first big
Test
ones.
Test one or whatever.
Yeah. And, Halidrol was by Gaspari. Gaspari, also made, did he make Super Pump 250?
I don't remember, but
because that's what made pre-workouts explode.
Isn't Gaspari connected to somebody else too, though? Wasn't he a pivot off of some other company or isn't he connected to somebody else?
Oh God, I don't remember.
I don't remember what they were. I don't know their history as well.
Who made Super Pump 250? It was Gaspari.
It was.
Gaspari pretty much invented the pre-workout market. That was the next big like evolution in supplements.
I wonder if that would be a great interview. We should put that down also as a cool interview, is to talk to them as to see if they had the foresight,
dude,
to know that their direction.
Let me tell you something right now. You want to talk about brilliant marketing, okay? Whether you, and look, everybody knows my stance or our stance on pre-workout mixes and whatever the bullshit, but you have to admire the marketing genius. He's being a bodybuilder. Gaspari was one of the best bodybuilders of the 80s, fucking shredded. That's what he was known for. Second place to Lee Haney all the time. Probably one of the greatest uncrowned bodybuilders of all time, up there with like Flex Wheeler and Kevin Lavrone. He, knowing muscle building, knowing the pull of lifting weights, he has the foresight to know that if he attaches a supplement that he can attach to giving you a better pump, because everybody loves a pump, he's going to sell a fuck ton of it.
Right.
That's what he does. Then he takes pictures. This was brilliant marketing in the magazines. I remember it like it was yesterday.
Before and after the pump, yeah.
Before and after the pump.
I remember that.
He would take dudes.
And anybody who'd ever fucking had a massive pump knows what that feels like. And
it's dramatic.
Like, yeah.
If I got a crazy pump, my before and after would look insane. You'd post it. And in the ads, it said, you know, they drank, you know, Super Pump 250, worked out. Look at the crazy pump they got. And these are people with a lot of muscle. They probably gave them a lot of water and carbs on top of it. And you see this huge difference. And it's the visual sale.
Well,
it's the visual
sale.
Well,
check this out. How crazy is this? How long was that in the verbiage when people would communicate about a workout? Like, hey, how was your workout today? Oh, bro, I got a massive pump.
Of course.
Yeah. Like that. Like, what does that translate to? Yeah. What the fuck does that mean?
Right.
Did you build muscle today?
Right.
But it became
part of the lingo.
Right. It became part of the lexicon, right? Was to talk about the pump in reference to how good of a workout was.
Yeah. And
how brilliant. And you attach that to a supplement.
Brilliant. Because he knew that already. And he also knew that there is some science that maybe the pump helps build muscle. So therefore, if we give you these nutrients that may do it or whatever, there's some science in his product because he put arginine knowing it's a precursor to nitric oxide. By the way, it's a horrible, it doesn't really do much for you, but he's taking, again, a little bit of science and kind of, and puts fucking stimulants in there.
Are you talking about the NO now? Are we going to the NO direction?
No, Super Pump 250 had that in there.
Oh, it had the NO in it?
Super Pump 250 had all the stuff that like No Explode and all.
Yeah. Well, I remember when that first hit
the market. He was the one that invented
that. When
that
first hit the market and I started diving into all of it and reading up on it, I'm like, wait a second. Like, even though all these studies are showing this, like what we still can't prove is that taking that nitric oxide actually even elevates the actual oxygen that's in your blood.
Oh, all that stuff?
Yeah. That it actually is, it actually
no,
does
it's just,
that.
But besides all that, like he invented that. He put a stimulant in there. You've got these pictures of before and afters, which are a pump, which are always going to look crazy. Now guys are taking this supplement and they're like, oh fuck, best workout ever, because they got, you know, 250 or whatever milligrams of caffeine in there plus other stimulants. Brilliant.
Yeah.
Completely.
Yeah, no, it was.
Completely shaped the supplement industry all over again.
Oh, yeah, it flipped it on its head because when you look at
it was a whole new category.
Well, and we did this not that long ago, right? We did a list, like, or we looked up or Googled, you know, the top 10 most sold supplements. And like out of the 10, fucking 6 are pre-workouts. Yeah. One's like a BCAA. Like, are you kidding? Look, there you go, BCAAs. Like, when did that come? Yeah. I don't remember who did
that.
So
BCAAs. BCAAs is old bodybuilding supplement that.
It wasn't BCAAs, though. It was called something else.
No, it was. Okay, so some of the oldest old school supplements you'll get for muscle building were protein powders, but they were typically mixes of like dry milk or something like that, and they were shit. But amino acids were some of the first supplements that were like not protein. And what they were initially is they were like desiccated liver tablets, or they'd call them, call them like aminos 1800. Remember these? Where it would just say aminos.
Yes, yes.
And all they were compressed fucking protein into tablets. That's all it was.
Like literally?
So yes.
Like you're getting like 2 grams of protein or what
is what?
Well, not even 2 grams.
You could have just taken like from whey and just
capsule.
Is that what they did?
Yes.
Get the fuck out of here.
I didn't know that.
Yes.
Oh, that's so gangster. So,
think about it. Okay. Let me ask you this. So it says 6 tablets is, you know, 1800 milligrams of amino acids.
No,
do you know what 1800 milligrams of amino acids is? What is it? 1.8 grams of protein.
Oh, wow.
That's what it is. It's 1.8 grams of protein, 1,800 milligrams of all these
which
amino acids.
Which they literally took what a, like, that would be like that's a tenth so, of a scoop. That's so a tenth gangster. Of a scoop
and
distributed
they press
over
them into tablets or capsules.
They're fucking smart.
And you used, remember we used to see those in the, you'd see them at the supplement stores and they'd be like, aminos 2,500 or super aminos 3,000. Or it was just protein.
It's like we compressed a little bit. We made them bigger pills.
We tricked you, assholes.
Bro, I bought one when I was a kid. I bought one
wow,
that was...
Wow, I can barely remember
it was
those.
Super Aminos 4,000. Of course, I got 4,000 because fucking it's more than 1,800.
I'm
going
four.
I'm going to go with the big one.
Were they like horse pills?
Yeah.
They were... Fuck, bro, I'm not exaggerating, okay? They were... Bro, oh, this is why I can swallow supplements and shit so well because I trained myself. Mm-hmm. They were tablets that were...
Sure wasn't all those dicks.
They were they were tablets that were this long,
yeah,
and they were that fat. It was like... For sure, people died trying to swallow this motherfucker, and you would end a serving of it was 10.
Oh my god!
And,
so
and,
that
the,
was,
and what it would take, what it would
10
say,
of those big ass 10. Things,
and what it would say is holy take shit. 10 in between every meal, and that's what you did, and it made the worst smelling farts of all time.
Oh my god!
Yeah, those were the first like
that's gnarly.
Those were the first supplements, bro. Then it was then they would sell like vitamins. Vitamins have been around for a long time. Then branched chain amino acids. Because studies were showing that giving branched-chain amino acids to people in protein-deprived states or burn victims and stuff
you know
like
what
that,
sucks?
They got better results. So then they sold the branched-chain amino acids.
Yeah.
That was a long time ago, dude. It just got rehashed. It got revamped.
Who was the first to really like start going crazy and like unethical with like the transformations? Was that like Xanadrine or one of those like
Cybergenics. Do you remember Cybergenics, Doug? Cybergenics in the 90s, dude. Do you guys remember these? It was a box that came with like fucking 10 different bot pills. And it would be like these crazy transformations. And what they were doing is they were doing the bodybuilder and telling them to go get fat
yes,
and stop lifting.
Yes, yeah. That became a thing. That was like a standard for a long time.
And you'd buy this box, which I bought, and it was expensive. It was like $100. And it came with a schedule of how you took these supplements. And it was... I think it was something like 10 different bottles of supplements. And as a kid wanting to build muscle, 100% believed it would work because it's 10 bottles of supplement. Of course it's going to work. It's fucking 10 bottles.
It's 10 bottles. By the time I'm there, I'm huge.
It's funny though, that's really the how we process shit like that. You know what's sad too? It makes me think of this when we were talking to Vinny the other day when we just interviewed him. Is when we were, because this guy, how old was Vinny? 50?
55,
right? So talk about, and he's been working out since he was 8 years old. Mm-hmm. So what a cool guy to talk to who's been in fitness for
he's
that many years.
Seen all the trends.
Yeah, right. So we had a great conversation and we talked about supplements a little bit in there, not as deeply as we are going right now. But the sad part that gets me frustrated, and it's why too, like when I even get into these debates with people online, I just like, I'm just give up. I'm like, I'm not even going to have this conversation. It's like 20 years ago, like this was even a conversation. Like it's gotten so crazy that we've got people debating over semantics, like over the smallest, we're splitting hairs already as it is.
Well, here's what they-
And then now we're like, someone will get in an argument with me, they're like, there's this study that shows it works. It's like, but bro, do you really understand what you're looking at? What you're looking at is like-
Or how about this?
When you talk about the order of all the things that you need to work on to be a buffer, leaner, better version of yourself, you are like, there's so much shit I can tell you right now that you can do.
Or even arguing over like stuff like this. Like here's the other thing the supplement industry does very well is when a winner is finally comes out. So every once in a while, a supplement will come out that is a winner in the sense that people either love them and buy them because like pre-workouts, they like the stimulants, they make them feel good and they're fun, whatever. Or because they actually work like creatine.
Right.
So now you've got a winner. Then, or protein powder. That's a winner, right? Protein powder, I can see some value in it.
You're about all the different formulations.
Then what they do is they take a winner.
They're doing that with creatine right now. I get people inboxing me all the time like, should I take this creatine, or this creatine? Which one's better? I saw this study that
said this. Monohydro 55.
And I just want to like slam my head in the wall.
It's because there's no longer a debate.
You know what I want to answer people? They're like, oh, definitely don't take that one. Take this one.
Right. Yeah,
exactly. I want to answer that way.
Just shit.
And you know what's crazy is I know it would make somebody happy.
That's right.
Like if
they
I did
want
that,
like a definitive
I guess,
answer.
Yeah, they want. Yeah. Like, just tell them like, oh no, stay away from that one. Definitely do that one.
No, it's
people are so funny.
Yeah, it's because
that's like 72% better.
Yeah,
for
it's
sure.
Because the argument
concrete
there's
all day,
no longer about the argument about like whether they work or not.
Right.
Everybody knows creatine works. So now we're going to make ours a way that,
right.
and sell it.
And then we start getting into all the semantics of it and breaking down every little minute thing.
Look at protein powder.
Yeah.
You've got fucking protein. They came out with protein powder pre-workout. Like, oh, no, different blend for post-workout. And then this is the nighttime blend because it's longer
acting. We talked about this before we went it up. So, you know, the history of before we even got connected with Organifi. And I remember, like, we almost started our own line. And it was, and we may one day, right? Because I still would love, in a perfect world to me, it would be like we've talked about, a fucking brown paper bag and just fucking raw whey.
Yeah.
Like raw creatine.
As pure as it gets.
Yeah, as like, pure as it gets.
No marketing involved.
Yeah,
no,
exactly.
Like, this is exactly brown, what you get.
Yeah, as cheap as we could possibly get it, but also from a fucking
extreme good quality.
Yeah, exactly. The highest quality.
No added
pure source.
Nothing.
Yeah, like I want to go straight to
you have to put it
in
your refrigerator.
I want to go to Colombia for cocaine, bro. I went straight from Colombia and then put it in a brown paper bag.
It is the purest of pure.
And I even want the label to say creatine.
Yeah.
Nothing else on it. On it. Just and that's all it is.
Yeah. One ingredient.
It tastes bland as fuck because it is bland.
And it says on it like, put it in your refrigerator because this is going to go bad.
Yeah. Right.
Because we've added nothing to it. Yeah. It's just pure this.
Yeah. So and I remember like we talked about this and I'm sure people were like, yeah, you should have done that. Well, it's cost a lot of money. Takes a lot of focus. To do something, owning or running a supplement business is a business in itself, and we're still in the middle of building and growing Mind Pump, and it's to me, and I think the boys, all of us agree, that's just not a priority right now.
No.
And so easier to go with somebody right now that has a message that aligns with our message, right? Like, if you are going to take things, here's, you know, protein, some green juice, if you don't get a lot of your greens and veggies, like some real basic stuff that you know is coming from a good source.
Right.
So that's kind of like, I feel like, you know, how
or just use them for fun. I mean, there's herbs and plants and supplements that do give you an effect, and you can, you know, play with certain things, which is totally fine. There's nothing wrong with that. It's just how much of an effect are you going to get when you're eating shit and you're not exercising or you're not doing the other things that are
I think that's what has always bothered all of us is the marketing behind it. I mean, it is what it is. Like, does it help to take these certain vitamins and minerals if you're lacking?
Well, I think the next big shift in supplements is
the transparency
is going to be transparency.
I agree.
Sources, like how organic it is, how good the sources, how pure it is. Here's all these independent lab results that you can see that show you. Right. I think that's the next evolution of supplements, and the ones that understand that are the ones that I think are going to
take you to the next level. It's such a bummer because in our industry and field, it's, you know, if you have any goals of being a hundred millionaire, you know, that's where
you
got to
go in that direction. Yeah.
I mean, it's crazy.
You got to make a lot of compromises.
I had a really good talk with Ben Pack the other day, and we were talking about this whole conversation. And I don't know. I can't disclose everything because I'm not sure what he's disclosed or not. But we did discuss all the different supplement companies out there and the type of money they make and this and that. And it's crazy that like even a supplement company that none of us have even heard of, you know, and you've never even seen probably – could easily make $10 million a year.
Mm-hmm. There's a lot of them.
Yeah, a lot. There's a lot of companies you've never heard of that make $10 to $50 million a year and nobody knows who the fuck they are. Mm-hmm. But because it's that easy that all you need to get is an X amount, a group of 5,000 to 10,000 people.
Here's the thing. There's no doubt, and this is the truth.
They want a pill to solve their problem.
This is the truth. We already have a large enough audience if we came out with a supplement.
So I didn't share this with you guys. You know, complete transparency on the show always that, so, you know, we hired a marketing team now to handle that for us. And forever, it took us a long time because we were waiting for someone that could see our message, that understood what we were trying to do. We finally figured that out. And we were talking, I wasn't just going to tell you about what we were talking about with him. What were we just talking about? About the...
We could come out. We have a large enough audience.
So he brings up to me that he has connections and relationships with supplement companies, and we start talking about manufacturing and what that would look like and this and that. And I was telling him, I said, listen, we have all that. I got all kinds of great connections for that. We could easily, I said, right now we have a $10 to $20 million supplement business on our hands if we wanted to. I said, but I don't want to do that. Like, I don't want, there's so many other things that all the boys and I like want to do for this company that is more important to us. Mm. To me, that would be like, and eventually I do want to provide that. Like, eventually it would be nice to do that, but
who knows? Maybe not. You know what I'm saying?
Like, no, but
you're not taking it off the table, but it's gotta be aligned with us.
Well, yeah. And that's what I was explaining to him is it's, we're not in that hurry to get that much money that we're just going to drop it out there right now. It's like, when we have time and we can spend on like, hey, let's talk about what this would look like.
This is a totem pole of priorities. I think we all sort of share a vision of where we want to take the company. And then once we kind of, you know, start notching these things off that we want to accomplish, it may make sense, you know, right, in the future.
Well, I think this is a cool discussion to have openly on the show too, because I think a lot of people don't think about this when they're going through a business that you got to think, it's not always about ROI. Right. There's definitely, if we decided to stop halt on all the things that we're working on and what we're trying to do within MindPup and said, hey, you know what? We've got fucking $10 million a year here right now. Let's get it. Let's put this to other stuff on the back burner. Let's get that because we know it's there. And if we spend the money, we spend the time that we can make that kind of money. It's like, well, yeah, but that's such a small, just like we talk about what it does for people. You know, to me, it's such a small part of what our business should represent. I don't want to be a supplement company.
And it's also
I've never wanted to be a supplement company.
We're driven by our message and our integrity and what we really, you know, I guess success is great. Monetary success is great. But there's the other side of success that we all consider to be very strong, priorities for us. And that's the success in actually influencing the industry a little bit for the positive.
Better behavior.
And better behavior and helping people to get to a point where health and wellness and fitness is how they live. And it's great and they love it and everybody feels good. And so that's the other side of success. I wouldn't feel successful if I made tens of millions of dollars and I didn't achieve any of that.
Well, especially if we did it through making supplements. It would eat away at me like crazy. It would eat away at me that it would become the most profitable part of the business, right? I don't want it. If it does, it won't be. That's how I feel. I feel like, and that's why I told, that's
it's
what
like
I was telling.
I was a stripper to pay for college, you know? I had to do it. Yeah.
It's like levels.
And if we do, I guess we'll just be honest, right? We'll just put it out there. We'll just tell them, listen, like, I'm doing this only because I'm trying to pay for college. Listen, everybody.
This is what I had to do. We're helping brother out.
Bro, we're not even finished with our website, dude. Like, come on. Like, our website's being redesigned right now. And that's such a high priority that there was no marketing on Facebook and social media. Like, there's so many other things that are way more important than doing that. You know what I'm saying? And so
I don't know.
A good discussion we needed to have.
It is. And I'll tell you what, every time I meet someone like Liz, who we met with in LA yesterday, and you meet a real fan and they talk about how much we've been able to impact them in all these positive ways, in all these very healthy ways.
Yeah.
Like that to me is like, that is such a big part of the success that I want.
Well, what was dope to hear her say that was really neat was to hear that, you know, her show is inspired from what we did. You know, like it's literally what inspired her to do that.
Sure. Yep.
And now our message is carrying on through somebody else who's now influencing. I mean, I don't know how many people are listening to her.
Message with a similar undertone. I mean, she's evolved it into something else, but it's awesome to watch.
We made a positive impact and you can't put a dollar sign on that.
No.
You just can't do it. So, you know, whatever. That's fine. I also believe though that, and look, history, there's lots of good examples of this where people kind of stuck to their, what they believed in.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it sounds like what they're doing is bad. Like, oh, you're making a bad decision. Dr. Dre did this several times where he left, you know, situations where he's already making shit tons of money and he just left it on the table because he didn't believe in it.
Yep.
Yeah. And look how, you know, stuff turned out for him.
Made a few flops and then he still kept going.
Steve Jobs? Fuck, he got fired, dude, from his own company.
You know why I think people like that and the brilliance in them, because a lot of people would try and argue probably that Dre's not the most brilliant man because he doesn't have this super high education or that, but he's definitely a visionary for sure.
Oh, come on.
Yeah, no,
you can't just measure brilliance and, you know, measured, you know, there's different types of brilliance.
Yeah, there is. To see that, right, to understand that, you know, you have to know, like, if you know if you're going to make something and become a billion-dollar company or even in the millions of dollars, right, like, you know the amount of time, dedication, and how much it's going to consume your life. Bottom line, like you're just, unless you get fucking lucky, you strike gold and you make a right call on a stock or some crazy shit or inherit something like that. If you build a fucking monster, you are married to it more so than you are your fucking spouse. So you better fucking love it and you better be in line with its values or else you're going to hate life.
Yeah.
And I think really, really intelligent guys like that see that and understand that and know like that is more important because you know that if I'm going to bury my, the way I'm going to become successful is I'm going to bury myself into this thing that I'm passionate and love. And I know that I'm talented enough that I could bury myself into anything and make it successful. But if I'm going to do this for life, it motherfucking better line up with
my. I want to change my answer. Okay, so I'm taking Dana White off the list. Okay, I'm putting Richard Branson in there instead.
Oh, boom. Oh. Yeah, some people said Richard Branson. Yeah. I actually said
I like
that.
Him a lot.
Oh, yeah, that was another guy I said that could easily make his way on that on that list, too. That's fucking for sure top five.
Good deal. Check it out. Go to mindpumpmedia.com. 30 days of coaching available for free, and it's for everyone. Also, if you go to YouTube, you can subscribe to our YouTube channel. We post a new video every single day. Look it up. It's called Mind Pump TV.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic, 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.